Hello all, it is Dr. Alsop here, and it is my absolute pleasure to get to discuss many of the general osteological structures that we want you to start becoming familiar with in this session. And some of these will come up again in subsequent sessions, and some are actually a review from previous sessions. As osteology is my absolute favorite, and since we have much to talk about, I can't wait to get started. So let's start with some basics of terminology before we move on to some of the finer scale detail. We are looking at a lateral view of the skull here. The term skull means the cranium plus the mandible. So here's your mandible. As we all know and love, if you did not have the mandible attached, this area would be called the cranium. The cranium is composed of the facial region, over here, or the facial region is often referred to as the viscerocranium, and the rest of the cranium is referred to as the neurocranium, which makes sense because that is where the brain is going to be housed, or what is protecting the brain. The neurocranium is further subdivided into the cranial base, or the basal cranium, where the brain sits, and the calvaria. More commonly called the roof of the cranial vault, so any area kind of up in this region. So the roof of the cranial vault, or more crudely put, the skull cap, these are all synonyms for calvaria. It is the calvaria that needed to be removed in order to obtain this superior view of the basal cranium, or the cranial base. Now, we have looked at this particular view before. We hopefully know by this point that this is going to be anterior, and this will be posterior back here. And here are your frontal bone, the sphenoid, the temporal bones, and the occipital bone. All right, so hopefully these things are a review. If you're not quite familiar yet with the bones that are in this particular view, make sure that you go back and review that, and we'll add on some additional bones as we move through the course. Now recall that there is an irregularly shaped foramen that's going to be between the temporal bones and the occipital bone. This is the jugular foramen, or the jugular foramina if you're talking about both of them, that the internal jugular vein, as well as cranial nerves 9, 10, and 11 will traverse. Next, let's review this anterior view with a focus on the frontal bone, and this is going to be the frontal bone up in this region. If you put your hand on your forehead, that frontal bone is living underneath there. Looking at the lateral and inferior most portions of the frontal bone, so here and here, you can see these extensions or processes. These are your zygomatic processes. And that makes sense because these are the parts of the frontal bone that are going to head towards or articulate with your zygomatic bone. More medially, within the supraorbital margin, you will see either a supraorbital notch or a supraorbital foramen. We are fortunate enough with this donor to see both, with a notch here on the left and the foramen over here on the right. It doesn't matter if it is a notch or a foramen, the same things are going to traverse this region, which is the supraorbital neurovasculature. Next, let's identify the temporal lines. Go back to the zygomatic processes of the frontal bone that we already located, and follow this line posteriorly. So it's heading back towards the parietal bones. These are the temporal lines. So here's the temporal line over here. This line is formed by the attachment of the temporalis muscle to this part of the bone. You may also have temporalis fascia that is going to attach here as well. Looking into the orbit, so we're going into the orbital region here, you can see a fairly large orbital part of the frontal bone. The frontal bone is actually forming the roof of the orbit, so that roof of the orbit inside that region of the frontal bone is referred to as the orbital part. And lastly, let's get an idea where the frontal eminence or eminences are located, which is about here-ish and here-ish. These are very slightly rounded eminences or elevations of the frontal bone. These, like we have here, are typically not very prominent in adult skulls. You can have it a little bit more inferior as well. These are generally larger in juvenile skulls. Let's continue the discussion of features of the frontal bone, but let's look at it from a more anterolateral view, which we can see here. The superciliary arches or ridges, which I am outlining right here, are superior to the supraorbital margins. The size of the arches can vary significantly between individuals, and that we're lucky enough that they're fairly obvious in this particular individual. The nasal part of the frontal bone is the part of the frontal bone closest to the nasal bones. So these are your nasal bones right here. And so these portions of the frontal bone would be considered part of the nasal part of the frontal bone. Moving into the orbital region of the frontal bone again, in this superolateral region, right about here-ish, can't see it particularly well over on this side, but it would be here-ish. So in the superolateral region, you will have the fossa for the lacrimal gland, which is what's producing tears. This is the part of the bone that that lacrimal gland will actually sit in and is protected by that particular parts of the bone. The trochlear fovea is on the opposite side. So we're heading more medial within the orbital region, so superior medial. This is where the trochlea of the superior oblique muscle sits. The superior oblique muscle is an extraocular eye muscle, and we'll talk about that a bit more detail in the orbit session. The last two things I want to identify in this view are the ethmoidal foramina, and I'm going to circle those here. These are these tiny holes in the medial portion of the orbit. And the anterior one is going to be the anterior ethmoidal foramen, since we're just looking at one. And the posterior one will, of course, be the posterior ethmoidal foramina. This allows ethmoidal neurovasculature to exit the skull. And you can see that these foramina are located right where the frontal bone is meeting the ethmoidal part of the orbit. All right, let's move on to some of the structures of the parietal bone. We are again looking at a lateral view of the cranium. Recall that the temporal line of the frontal bone is going to be about here. We saw it from a more anterior view before. So right around this region. The temporal line of the frontal bone is going to be there. This line will extend into the parietal regions. So sometimes it's difficult to tell the difference between the superior and inferior temporal lines. Fortunately, on this particular individual, I think it's actually a bit more obvious. Here is the superior temporal line, which is formed by the attachment of temporal fascia. And this one right here will be the inferior temporal line, which is formed by the most superior attachment of the temporalis muscle, so one of those muscles of mastication. Now let's look at the parietal bones from an internal view. So this is that calvaria, but we are looking at it, we're looking into it, so into the internal portions of it. This here is going to be anterior, this will be posterior. I can tell this for a few reasons. One of the main reasons here is you can see how thick the bone is right here. The occipital is going to be a little bit thicker than what you have in the frontal bone. Running down this midline region here, you will have a distinct groove. You can see it a little bit from this image. You're going to have a distinct groove portion of the parietal bones, and you can also see it's extending into the frontal bone region as well. This groove was formed by the superior sagittal sinus, thus the name groove for superior sagittal sinus. Near this groove, you will see various holes. You see a very distinct one here. You see a few around this region. These are referred to as granular foveolae. These are formed by arachnoid granulations, which we know are very closely associated with the superior sagittal sinus and the lacunae, so how we are getting that CSF into the venous drainage region. All right. Lastly, we see all these beautiful grooves on the more lateral portions of the internal parietal bones. I can see them particularly well on this anterior portion of the parietal bone on this particular donor. You can see some that are a bit more posterior as well on the parietal bone. These are grooves for the middle meningeal artery. This name would actually be more descriptive if it was grooves for branches of the middle meningeal artery. So the middle meningeal artery will send numerous branches throughout this region because it's a really important supply to the meninges. All right, moving back to an external, but this time a posterior view of the parietal bones. So here are your two parietal bones. Here's your occipital here, just for review. Now you see these two prominent eminences here. Can you see kind of where it looks like the parietal bone is kind of bulging out in this region? These are important ossification centers, so where we have the development of bone. These eminences become less prominent with age, but on this particular donor, they're quite prominent. Very close to the sagittal suture that's running right down the midline here, you have these two very small foramina, which are referred to as the parietal foramen, if you're talking about one of them, or foramina if talking about both. These particular foramina are going to allow for the parietal emissary veins to traverse. So you'll have various areas of the skull where you will have foramina to allow emissary veins to traverse. They're important in terms of connecting the venous sinuses inside to the scalp veins outside. So this particular region right here would be the parietal emissary veins. Additionally, you may not have parietal foramina, so they may be absent in some individuals, and you'd have them in other areas of the skull. All right, this next structure should be a nice review, as we covered this in the anterior neck session as well. So why don't we use this as a means of reviewing? Try by yourself to locate or identify where the external openings for the carotid canal are located. So pause the video if you want to take a second to do that. All right, so hopefully you took some time to review it, and let's see if you got it right. So here and here are going to be the external openings of the carotid canal, and this is how the internal carotid artery is going to enter the skull. So hopefully you got that right. If you didn't, that's okay. You know that this is an area you need to review, and it's always nice to kind of self-check there. All right, now looking at a posterior view, the dominant bone you can see here is the occipital bone, and we will focus on two structures we want you to identify in one part. Now, this whole region here of the flatter portion of the occipital bone is referred to as the squamous part. We will come back to the squamous part in different views, so just know that it's that flatter part of the bone. Now, I want you to take your hand now and feel the back of your own head until you feel a big bump. That bump you feel is the external occipital protuberance, and that is a long name, but a pretty descriptive one. That bump you can see I've labeled right here in terms of where it's located on the skull. Now, extending laterally from the external occipital protuberance is the superior nuchaline, which is often considered a superior limit of the neck, as this is one of those attachments of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So this can be variably large in individuals. Some individuals will not be particularly robust, and others it will be. Now let's focus on the occipital bone from this superior view of the basocranium. So this view comes up over and over again, so I hope you're getting more and more used to it. There are two main parts of the bone that we can identify here. Again, here is that squamous part of the occipital bone. So that flatter, larger part of the occipital bone. Whereas here is considered the basilar or the basilar part of the occipital bone. Sometimes you'll hear this particular area right here referred to as the clivus of the occipital bone. In fact, I often kind of prefer that term, so you may hear me say that often. All right, corresponding closely to the external occipital protuberance, but inside, will be the smaller internal occipital protuberance, or this bump right here. This is going to be the posterior attachment point for the falx cerebri, so one of those dural partitions. Now on either side, and we'll follow, I believe, on this side, on either side of the internal occipital protuberance, you will see a groove extending, shouldn't take that little curve there, extending laterally. This is where the transverse sinus sat during life. These will continue laterally, and when they take a turn inferiorly, these are going to be referred to as the groove for the sigmoid sinus. So the transverse sinus sat here, the sigmoid sinus sat here during life, and it formed these grooves in the bone. And it makes sense that this would be the sigmoid sinus, because see where it's heading. It is heading towards the jugular foramen, which the sigmoid sinus with the inferior petrosal sinus will form the internal jugular vein. So that sigmoid sinus should continue to the jugular foramen. Fairly obvious here, you have the foramen magnum. So that big hole right there in the middle of the occipital bone. Here again, you have the jugular foramina. So that sigmoid sinus is leading into the jugular foramen. The portion of the foramen that is of the occipital bone is referred to as the jugular notch of the occipital. There is also a jugular notch of the temporal bone, and when you put those together, you have the jugular foramen. Lastly, let's identify the hypoglossal canals, and I think you really only can see it well on this right side here. It would be right about here-ish on the left. I always look toward the foramen magnum region when trying to identify these and start heading towards the basilar part or the basilar part, and that's where you would have these openings for the hypoglossal canal, which will allow the hypoglossal nerve or cranial nerve 12 to exit the skull. Lastly, let's look at the occipital bone and its features from an inferior view. Here again is going to be the squamous part. Here is the basilar part. And right here in the middle of the basilar part from this inferior view, you're going to have a bump. And this bump is referred to as the pharyngeal tubercle. It is here that that pharyngeal raphe for those pharyngeal constrictor muscles is going to attach. Here are two of my favorite features of the occipital bone, which are your occipital condyles, here and here. These will form a joint with the first cervical vertebrae, C1, or the atlas, all synonyms for the same bone. This allows for the movement that you make when you shake your head yes, so that joint between C1 and the occipital condyles. Lastly, next to the posterior extent of the occipital condyles, you may or may not see what's referred to as condylar canals. You more often will see them than not, so it's more frequent than not. These are another means for emissary veins to traverse, specifically the occipital emissary veins. All right, so that was a lot of osteology fun, and as you work your way through reviewing this material, please do let me know if you have any questions, and I'll be super excited to discuss. Thank you and have a great day.